So, what's up, guys? So, I wanted to do this video to once again respond to Bane666. Now, I actually like to personally schedule a Skype or G Plus conference call with him in the near future to avoid, you know, any more BS from either one of our audiences basically going after each other. Specifically his audience, you know, attacking me and belittling me and making threats, you know, basically saying that I should kill myself and other things, like basically just to, you know, get off me. So that's why I believe in basically having a conference call with him where we can just basically talk, you know, person to person. I understand this may be a little bit difficult for both of us, considering that he is Australian, I assume, and that I'm an American. I'm from California, so there's going to be a large time difference. I believe 17 hours, probably, time difference, as well as differences in the days. Because, you know, international dateline, which is a bitch. Anyway, so basically I wanted to just respond to him from what the videos that he's put up so far as of this recording, and essentially just respond back to him. Now, I will admit there are some things that I will actually retract, and some things I will do more research on, and we'll discuss that all, you know, in the future, I suppose. So basically, here we go. First off, let me say that the penis positive thing that was made at the very beginning of this series made me laugh till I wanted to throw up. So hats off to you on that one. I have to agree with that. You have definitely had me on the red herring arguments, as well as the there was another one down the line, I'll get to it, but he definitely had me on the red herring argument thing, and I retract my statement on that, because reviewing back through that, you do have some good points, so I'm just, and throughout this video, you're gonna hear me say, I'm gonna give you that one a lot, probably as much as you heard reactionary. Yeah. Anyway, I will admit that I probably do not know as much about the sentencing gap as I may suggest. I will look further into it. And you'll have to excuse me, as the term reactionary that I use several times, to me personally, is being used from a Marxist perspective, which is not necessarily about a reaction to something, but more so the idea that it is an opposition to revolutionary idealism, which I will also define that in just a second, or progressivism. And revolutionism is essentially basically any form of like radical progress, radical change to a society. Typically we use it in the Marxist perspective to describe our struggle for basically getting rid of the class society, getting rid of the idea of gender struggle and stuff like that, and racism, and etc., etc. So that's what I mean by revolutionaries, a way of radically basically getting rid of or fighting against these sort of elements which we will call reactionary, because for instance, the whole system of the government, we'll take the U.S. as a good example since I live under it, the crime against African Americans in Ferguson, New York, and things like that. Those are what we would call a reaction to, or an opposition to, a social justice sort of issue, a issue of trying to address and combat racism. And the U.S. regime responds back with acts of bloody violence, you know, in some cases deadly violence. So hopefully that kind of explains it a little better, because I know I needed to clarify quite a lot in that. Now, I will say, however, that you and I would probably agree on quite a lot of different things, as you suggest throughout your videos, so I don't see how I'm fighting against progress or standing in the way or anything that supports the status quo. Perhaps I'm somehow misrepresenting myself when I'm talking. I tend to do that a lot. I don't know how I can go about clarifying those particular issues. I'm just trying to basically put it out there, dude, that I'm not, I'm not trying to be an asshole or anything in any way. Goddamn freaking allergies. I'm basically not trying to be an asshole or come off as narcissistic or arrogant or anything like that. I'm just, I am going off my opinions a lot of the time. Most of my channel is about opinions and certain things. Sometimes things that I do that are based upon fact from particular things that go on within my own realm of the world. Particularly politics is one of those definite things that I focus on. So that's why when I respond to you, my posts are often a little asinine and unorthodox, because basically I am pretty much going off of no notes. I'm going off of, you know, the fact that I have a very strong opinionated nature, and those are things that I need to work on. I think as do we all. But the point is that I didn't mean to come off to you or your audience as intellectually lacking, because I think we both know that I'm better than that. My audience knows that I'm better than that. And I will agree that in some parts of my video, at the very least, were unorthodoxed and piss poor. So we can probably agree on that. Let me get back to a few notes that I also have here. That you called me a feminist. In fact, you referred to me quite a few times, or at least indirectly, referred to me as a feminist. And I believe I mentioned it in that last video response to you, or somewhere, that I don't really identify as a feminist. I identify because I find that term fucking redundant, and that I view myself as more of a gender equalist if I have to put a label on it, because my ideal of gender equality is part of a component of the science of Marxism. It's kind of part of that whole idea of camaraderie. So, yeah, that's why I say I prefer the term gender equalist or just outright Marxist, as my Marxist beliefs kind of ingrain that ideal. Perhaps it's safer for me to say that feminism, particularly, well, I use the term radical feminism, but let's just go with feminism. Let me first say this. Radical feminism, I believe, is much like the Tea Party to the U.S., USA's Republican Party. It is basically a hijacked group of individuals that has taken control of the feminist movement. And so we could make the argument that the feminist movement has basically become... Yeah. Okay, I'll make a motion for that one. Thoughts? Anyway, but yeah, I believe that personally the idea that feminism and the MRMs were the opposition to progress, and that what we really all are, that being your audience and my audience, really what we all are, gender equalists. I think that would be a fair thing. From the sounds of things that I've heard you say, from the things that I've actually will give into, I would say that we're pretty gender equals in, you know, fighting for those gender equal sort of frames of mind. I just personally think that we all just go about it through different methods and are looking at it through a perspective lens of our own. I would also like to say on Russian Deadpool, just to clear this out of the way, let me just first state, because not that you were said anything about me or anything, but I wanted to just make it known to you and your audience and everything that I don't subscribe to his way of thinking. I think that his way of thinking is, yeah, I'm going to use the term hopelessly flawed. I think that there is a tremendous level of, I definitely think that he is definitely he's counter-progressive, in my personal opinion. I think that he has opinions that you and I both can agree with, all of our audiences can agree with, but he is, I would say that he's more of a person that is standing in the way of progress than I am. In fact, from the sounds of things, he's... Yeah. So, just to put a word to it, instead of yeah, he's basically one of those people that I would call, I'm sorry, a reactionary, because he's in opposition to the level of progress that you are after, that I'm after. He really doesn't do a damn bit of good for anybody, including himself. So, my opinion on him, not very favorable. I do want to make a point on universally for these videos that you have done is that there's a large difference between the American legalism and Australian legalism, which from the looks of the AU at the end of your username and your accent, I assume means you're from Australia. Neither of us really understands each other's legal systems very well, and much less the corruption that goes on within each other's countries. I know that Australia and the U.S. both have similar legal systems, but also vastly different in some ways, too. I know that there's also a great amount of corruption in both, though I prefer not to argue which ones are worse. U.S. But essentially, I just wanted to say that you and I don't really... That's one of the problems I think that you and I have, is the fact that we both try to look at things at a global perspective, but we also have... this perspective of what where we come from is like. And so there's probably this slight societal or national gap in some ways between us, as well as the fact that I don't know what state or province you hail from in Australia. I myself hail from California, and so our state laws are distinctly defined from federal law. Now, that doesn't mean that we're exempt from federal law. That means we still have to follow federal law, but states essentially have rights to their own self-determination. So as long as it isn't necessarily violating federal law, we basically have a right to pretty much make whatever law we want. And not say that there isn't bureaucracy and corruption, there we go, that exists within my state level, but nationally, we're getting pretty fucked over, so, yeah. But then again, you probably are too, who knows. I get the feeling this is all getting to be very irrelevant now and getting off topic again. But one of the bones that I would like to throw to you is I would like to retract and update my arguments on male homelessness. To start, I think I tend to look at things from an observational and American perspective, much more so as a Californian and a regional perspective that I have. As you know, I live in the northern San Francisco Bay Area, so, yeah. Perhaps it's also the fact that I just, that because of one of these observational perspectives that I have, I see just as many homeless women as I do homeless men, running around my particular neck of the woods, though I know that's not realistically, representative of the rest of the world. So there's also definitely seems to be more of a male issue than a female issue. Whether MRM, gender equalist, feminist, blah blah blah, we all seem to argue that male homeless military veterans far outweigh female, so that I will give to you. I do basically have to make one argument though. And I believe the reason for the male homeless veterans is partially due to the fact that they've been traditionally sent to war because nations have had this demand for greed and wealth for power, i.e. capitalism, and thus a need to expand, imperialism, and the fact that only within the last 15, 20 years, at least in my country, have women basically been allowed to enter combat. In fact, I think it was only like 10 years ago that, less than 10 years ago even, that women were even allowed to drive tanks. So essentially that what I'm trying to get at is I think there's a level of discrimination when it comes to the military, which then leads to this weird, you know, kind of, it's that opposite and equal reaction sort of thing, where because women are discriminated against in the military, it seems to swing back that other direction where men end up falling into this really bad position where then they lose limbs or their lives, and if they do make it back, then they've got PTSD and a lot of other issues and basically make up, you know, they can't survive in the real world, and they end up homeless, or whatever the cause is that they end up homeless. So I think it begins with the system. I think it's also a really big issue when it comes to the military and its discrimination, which I think kind of has that, you know, action opposite equal reaction thing. So yeah, I think that that's a theory anyway. There's no proof to that, obviously. You probably expected that of me, but because I can't really provide proof to a theory of mine. It's just a it's just a thought. But it's a thought I thought we could marinate on. Where was I in my notes? Oh, yeah. Personally, I think one issue lies with the fact that there needs to be more involvement of women in the military operations, as I mentioned a minute ago. And if nations are going to send their troops off to war, we should have just as many women serving as men. I would agree, too, that it appears women tend to get more benefits than men, but I believe some women hold more priority than other women, and then that also plays a weird, you know, effect on the increase in male homelessness, or the outrageous number of male homelessness. And because of that, that is perhaps why more women veterans seem to get better treatment, because, again, as you stated, women tend to get better treatment, but it seems like when it's women in the military, they seem to get better treatment once they're out of uniform than it is when they're in there. And personally, I think I will agree with you that we probably should start kind of, if we're going to basically treat women as equals in the military, that camaraderie that we should be having, then we should be, you know, then we should basically be treating men and women as equals outside. So there's a lot of issues that go on with all that. I still think, however, the system does treat veterans with overall contempt. I believe that when veterans come home, at least, I don't know how it is in Australia, but I know, I don't know how it is in Australia, but I know in the U.S. that we have this mentality that we're so pro-military until the troops come home, and then all of a sudden it's just like, yo, thanks for your service, now go get a job, you bum. It kind of seems like that's the mentality of certain people. However, I would still say that if 25% of homeless individuals are female, that would still make up enough of a minority group that it still makes it a non-gender issue. Though I do understand that what you're saying, that it is definitely more swayed towards males. And I think another member of your audience made that argument as well. Let's see. I think we should focus on eradicating the homelessness in women while simultaneously trying to reduce and eradicate homelessness in the male population. Because I think that this is kind of, it's a weird step, but I think that if we focus on trying to get rid of that minority, reducing and eradicating the poverty level in one minority group while also simultaneously trying to reduce it in the male minority group, you know, there might be better ends to that. Or vice versa. We could actually start reducing it in the male minority group and try to drop that down to, you know, a point where maybe it is a bit more 50-50. Maybe that's a better idea. I don't know where I was going with that earlier. Again, one of the biggest contributions to the poverty issue is largely based on the class system, in my personal opinion. I would also say that if anything is more of a gender issue, then let us look at drugs, which I don't have a statistic on it, but I would assume that the likelihood is more men, I think, are probably more susceptible to the ravages of drug abuse and alcoholism, and perhaps we need to relax drug laws and have more of a priority on helping them get clean and sober, thus allowing them for better chances at life. I don't have a statistic on it. I'm just assuming that there is probably more of a substantial vulnerability, susceptibility of men getting addicted to drugs and alcohol, particularly men that have that come home from the military and have issues like PTSD and other things like that. But ultimately, I think the problem lies with the system. Another big issue that you mentioned was the domestic abuse and sexual violence argument, which if 95% of the veterans are homeless, then part of that large demographic of homeless men are men with PTSD and other issues. And that's not taking away that some haven't been sexually or domestically abused, but the numbers I've been given seem to suggest that the number of men that suffer from that are roughly lower, if not the same number of women that have been abused, and I believe you clarified that 40 to 50%, and you're not actually the first person that's given me that rough estimation. That was given to me by another MRM, a former friend of mine. Won't get into that, but point is that he gave me that statistic, so forgot what source he cited, but anyway, thus that's why I consider it more of a non-gender specific or human issue, because I think that it has to do with the idea that even though women are more of the minority group in the homelessness population, there's still a significant amount of them that I think that both need to be largely focused on and more awareness brought to it. I think more issues should be brought to the idea of homelessness in general, because I don't know how it is where you're from, but in America it's pretty crap. We're having homelessness basically criminalized in my country, so yeah, that's how crap it is. Whether or not men are taken seriously, though, is clearly a defining problem. However, I did not imply that this system was matriarchal or patriarchal. You claim, were trying to somehow, you know, make some sort of claim. I was trying to say that it was patriarchal. I didn't really get to that until I think the end of the video, and when I started talking about forms of patriarchy, which I will get to in a minute, was crap. You say feminists tend to only focus on men at the top and ignore the men at the bottom. Again, I'm not a feminist, and I do not ignore the people at the bottom. I take into account that men are substantially oppressed who are working class or who are gay or even non-Christian. It just depends on what perspective you look at it, as it's, in this case, there are far too many different ways we could skew these lines off to. It's not saying I don't care about male homelessness, more that I am just not looking at it in terms of gender specifics, and more just straight down the middle. However, I don't think that there's necessarily a problem with looking at it down the middle, and I don't think any of us should have a problem with it looking straight down the middle. I do agree that maybe more time should be spent examining male homelessness a little more. Or possibly just at all, because in my country we pretty much treat the homelessness with utter contempt. I do agree that more should actually be brought, issues should be brought, more say should be brought to the issue of general mutilation, and I do agree that there is a large double standard. So I think you and I will agree 115% on this, and no, in this particular instance, when you asked me if it was a red herring, like I said, I retracted that in this. I'm retracting my red herring statements from my previous video, so no, in this instance, it's not definitely not a red herring. And I will agree that I was contradictory on that. in response to my experience with the MRAs, it's is quite possible that I have come across those that are extremist and have painted it in a bad light. My former friend being one of those people who quite honestly was just a gigantic troll. On the issue of father's rights, I thought I had clarified this in my previous video about women who are violent should not have custody either. If I didn't, then I apologize for that. But basically, that's what I'd like to say. That women who also have histories of violence or are violent in some way, they should not have custody either. I did not specify parents for God knows why. I don't know what time I filmed that video, so it may have been late. Who knows? I don't have an excuse for it. So, yeah, I simply was thinking of male, female, etc., etc., and the unisex term of just parental rights just didn't come to my head at the time. So I do apologize for that. Let me be very clear, though, where I stand. I am slightly biased. My father was never in my life. The people and the people I have met who were men's rights activists or father's rights activists were not entirely too friendly to me. I've had really negative experiences dealing with people. Some were just massive trolls. Some were I've actually had a few that literally got to the point that were kind of like how certain feminists are with how they talk about wanting to chop men's dicks off and stuff like that. I had some men that were kind of men's rights activists that were basically very militant against women and women's rights. To the point that I would actually almost call it like what we call the term what we coined with feminazis. I would almost say that these guys were like, you know, were male, you know, these guys were Nazis themselves in some ways, I guess. I don't know what a term would be to coin that in the Nazis. I don't know. But they were just not very friendly. So my experience was pretty negative. I'm not really saying that I don't support the idea of fathers being in kids' lives. I personally think if either parent has the capacity to care or prove they are not a threat to each other or their children, then I think there is nothing wrong with either of them seeing their kids. Where I live in California, however, there does not seem to be much of a parental rights issue, much less a father's rights issue. Fathers get paternity leave, mothers get maternity leave. The law states that in divorces that it's 50-50 right down the middle unless somebody claims domestic violence. And yes, there's a lot of reform that needs going on in that. But then again, so does the rest of America. But essentially, where I come from, you have to understand why I have some of the views that I do. I come from a state where things are a lot more cushy than a lot of other parts of the U.S. or a lot of other parts of the world. For instance, my religious views of me being a Wiccan, I am more accepted in California where I live than I would be, say, if I was down in the deep south. It's one of those things where I have that I, you know, live more of a cushier lifestyle than I do. It's just, yeah. That's kind of an example I'm trying to give to my background and trying to understand me a little bit more. I personally think that, yeah, let's see, I'm off my notes here. At least I'm not off my meds. I'm just kidding, I don't take meds. prescribed him, never took him. Yeah, so perhaps I'm a little that's what I wanted to say, that I'm perhaps a little bit regionalistic, and I definitely should take a look outside where it doesn't affect me or my state of residence. So I agree that possibly stepping outside those boundaries might help. What I said about feminism is that they are fighting gender what I said about feminism is that they are fighting gender roles and patriarchy, but in doing so they are creating a nationalist movement out of it. By that I mean that they are, for example, we both talked about the NOW. These groups, they've done a lot of good in trying to bring about LGBT equality and talking about women's rights and all these great things. But when it comes to when it comes to their idea of fighting gender roles, yeah, they do. They fight the patriarchy, but in doing so, they actually do kind of create this almost idealism of superiority. And I think you and I would both agree with that, that they do have, that these groups do have this level of superiority that they give this aura of, to say the least of. They're a lot of these groups are heavily militant. I'll be honest, they scare me. They really do. They are groups that, as I've used the term reactionary to describe, they are definitely one of those that I would say kind of oppose certain levels of progress. I would say that they actually do more damage than they do good in these things, and why I kind of really don't think that certain groups should associate themselves with them. But, you know, it is what it is, I guess. So yeah, like I said, that's equally detrimental. And then I've talked about the reactionary, revolutionary term, so I don't really need to repeat myself on that. What I will say is, we could make the argument that you were talking about, we could make the argument that Marxism is reactionary to capitalism, if we look at it from a capitalist perspective, as it is the opposition to statism, and the ideal of making profit off the exploitation and expense of workers who were given slave wages, basically, that people can't realistically get by on, at least not in America. However, if we look at the idea of Marxism in terms of the Marxist perspective, we believe ourselves to be revolutionary in the fight for the rights of workers. However, this does not mean that all so-called Marxists are fighting for some form of progressivism, as some actually can be counterproductive or become as such to the cause of rapid progress. Thus, they themselves can be considered reactionary because they oppose certain things. Let me give you an example of my personal perception of it, is that Stalin, for instance, was a reactionary of Leninist Bolshevism. He was, he played the role of being this, you know, ardent supporter of workers' rights and everything else, but essentially, he turned the Soviet Union basically into this ultra-militaristic, this syncretic nationalist sort of movement, dare I say, even a quasi-fascist. He literally turned Lenin's dream and took a huge dump on it. So, yeah. I'm also not trying to sound like a trot, because I don't really care for that either. But anyway, yeah. So that's really the best example I can give in terms of that. Your arguments against male privilege, I would say are just about as flawed as my arguments in favor of it. I think that maybe had I actually taken more time to actually explain that, perhaps then we could have, both of our arguments would have been better. I don't know. I just think that personally, it's probably one of those situations where my lack of wanting to even try to explain it probably perceives your lack of, you know, trying to, your lack of arguing against it. So, I think personally we both have an issue with that. But I think it also, a perfect word that you used was that the reason why this is because the issue of male privilege and the issue of the male-female relationship sort of issue when it comes to male privilege is complex. I would tend to agree because it really is. It's the whole dynamic of it's really hard to get into because, again, we could go on this whole, you know, spiel about, you know, white versus black, gay versus straight, you know, that nonsense, and it's, yeah, again, one of those things that it would be better just to hash out and stuff like that in a personal conference. But yeah, complex was a good word to describe it. Then again, so is politics. I would also make one argument to say, though, that if I'm ignoring statistics across the Western world, what about statistics in the third world, then? I mean, if these are truly global statistics, then what about men in the third world compared to women, or men in the third world compared to men in the first world? Statistics across the Western world doesn't necessarily satisfy a global majority. It just kind of gives a dynamic of what's going on in our neck of the woods. And so it's kind of, you know, it'd be nice to kind of have a little bit of an expansion on that. So, yeah, if I'm ignoring the statistics of the Western world, then, which is based more on ignorance on my part, then you are ignoring the statistics in the third world, which I think is just as important. And just because 75% of the male of the homeless are male and we don't take male issues seriously doesn't necessarily discredit the idea that male privilege exists. It simply means that we have a problem with certain aspects of communication and addressing these concerns, but it doesn't necessarily discredit the idea that male privilege exists. Just like people saying, you know, trying to make certain arguments about why white privilege doesn't exist. And there are people that make similar cases out of that where they try to justify the racial inequality and stuff like that between whites and African Americans, or whites and blacks, just to be more universal, because, you know, they, you know, and all they're really doing is perpetrating this sort of white supremacist sort of, not white supremacist, more white colonizer is what I'm, mentality. So I'm not trying to compare the two, I'm just saying that there, to try to deny that certain male privileges exist, trying to deny that male privilege exists is like trying to deny that white privilege exists. And let's be honest, whites also have privilege. Now watch, I'm going to get somebody that's going to argue me on that one too. So you and I basically are just going to have to kind of agree to disagree on that particular issue on male privilege, because it's not really going to go anywhere. And I was not really taught, and when I was talking about the issue of the men and women in the workplace, I was referring to sexual harassment, not sexual assault. Little bit of a difference there. So that's why I was saying that women are more susceptible to sexual harassment, not assault. So yeah, when referring to political power, I was referring to men in positions of power, such as politicians and businessmen, not voters. So I wanted to clarify that. And that's basically the only thing I really have to say on that. I want to thank you, though, for being civil and trying to keep your composure. I know it wasn't easy. And it's something I cannot say for... And frankly, it's a lot better than I can say for half of your audience, who frankly insulted my intelligence and opened some old wounds for me. At least with you, I can honestly say that we have agreed on some things, we've disagreed on other things, and even came to clarify, and I have retracted my statements on and have updated my views on certain elements. You did not demean me or make me feel stupid like half your audience did, and I think if there were more people like you and more people like one individual I spoke to that in the comments sections who was more open-minded, I think that the world would be a whole lot better. And with some more research, perhaps I will come to see more of your point of view, although I personally think you and I are more gender equalist than either one of us will admit, because I don't really view myself as a feminist. I don't really see you as men's rights. I see you more as a gender equalist. So, yeah, that's really all I gotta say. I want to just thank you for at least being civil to me, and, again, maybe we can pick this up on, a Skype or G+ call or something like that. So, I'm NorCal Nick, leader of the revolutionist movement, and this has been NorCal Corner. Peace.